Vedanta and Buddhism.
Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa.
A comparative study by Helmut von Glasenapp. The Wheel Publication, number 2. Preface. The present treatise by Professor Dr. H. von Glasenapp has been selected for reprint, particularly in view of the excellent elucidation of the Anatta doctrine, which it contains. The treatise in its German original appeared in 1950 in the proceeding of the Akademie der Wissenschaften and Literature, Academy of Sciences and Literature. The present selection from that original is based on a bridge translation published in the Buddhist Volume 21, number 12, Colombo, 1951. Partial use has also been made of a different selection and translation which appeared in the Middle Way, Volume 31, number 4, London, 1957. The author of this treatise was an eminent Indologist of Western Germany, of the University of Königsberg. He also occupied the Indological Chair of the University of Tübingen. Among his many scholarly publications are books on Buddhism, Hinduism, Jainism, and on Comparative Religion, Buddhist Publication Society. Vedanta and Buddhism. Vedanta and Buddhism are the highlights of Indian philosophical thought. Since both have grown in the same spiritual soil, they share many basic ideas. Both of them assert that the universe shows a periodical succession of arising, existing, and vanishing, and that this process is without beginning and end. They believe in the causality which binds the result of an action to its cause, karma, and in rebirth conditioned by that nexus. Both are convinced of the transitory and therefore sorrowful character of individual existence in the world. They hope to attain gradually to a redeeming knowledge through renunciation and meditation, and they assume the possibility of a blissful and serene state in which all worldly imperfections have vanished forever. The original form of these two doctrines shows, however, strong contrast. The early Vedanta formulated in the most of the old and middle Upanishad, in some passages of the Mahabharata and the Puranas, and still alive today, though greatly changed, as the basis of several Hinduistic systems, teaches an ens realicism, an entity of highest reality, as the primordial cause of all existence, from which everything has arisen and with which it again merges, either temporarily or forever. With the monistic metaphysics of the Vedanta contrasts the pluralistic philosophy of flux of the early Buddhism of the Pali texts, which up to the present time flourishes in Ceylon, Burma, and Siam. It teaches that in the whole empirical reality there is nowhere anything that persists. Neither material nor mental substances exist independently by themselves. There is no original entity or primordial being in whatsoever form it may be imagined from which these substances might have developed. On the contrary, the manifold world of mental and material elements arises solely through the causal cooperation of transitory factors of existence, dharma, which depend functionally upon each other, that is, the material and mental universe arises through the concurrence of forces that, according to the Buddhist, are not reducible to something else. It is therefore obvious that deliverance from samsara, i.e. the sorrow-laden round of existence, cannot consist in the reabsorption into an eternal absolute which is at the root of all manifoldness, but can only be achieved by a complete extinguishing of all factors which condition the process constituting life and world. The Buddhist Nirvana is therefore not the primordial ground, the eternal essence which is at the basis of everything and from which the whole world has arisen, the Brahman of the Upanishad, but the reverse of all that we know, something altogether different which must be characterized as nothing in relation to the world, but which is experienced as highest bliss by those who have attained to it. Anguttara Nikaya 9:34. Vedantists and Buddhists have been fully aware of the gulf between their doctrines, a gulf that cannot be bridged over. According to the Majjhima Nikaya Sutta 22, a doctrine that proclaims the same is the world and the self. This I shall be after death, imperishable, permanent, eternal. See Brahdaranyaka Upanishad 4.4.13. Was styled by the Buddha a perfectly foolish doctrine. On the other side, the Katha Upanishad 4.14 does not see a way to deliverance in the Buddhist theory of dharma's impersonal processes. He who supposes a profusion of particulars get lost like rainwater on a mountain slope. The truly wise man, however, must realize that his Atman is at one with the universal Atman, and that the former, if purified from dross, is being absorbed by the latter, just as clear water poured into the clear water becomes one with it indistinguishably. Vedanta and Buddhism have lived side by side for such a long time that obviously they must have influenced each other. The strong predilection of the Indian mind for the doctrine of universal unity, monism, had led the representatives of Mahayana to conceive samsara and nirvana as two aspects of the same and single true reality. For Nagarjuna, the empirical world is a mere appearance, as all dharmas manifest in it are perishable and conditioned by other dharmas without having any independent existence of their own. Only the indefinable voids, sunyata, to be grasped in meditation and realized in nirvana, has true reality. This so-called middle doctrine of Nagarjuna remains true to the Buddhist principle that there can be nowhere a substance, insofar as Nagarjuna sees that last unity as a kind of abyss. Characterized only negatively, which has no genetic relation to the world. Asanga and Vasubandhu, however, in their doctrine of consciousness only, have abandoned the Buddhist principle of denying a positive reality which is at the root of all phenomena, and in doing so, they have made a further approach to Vedanta. To that Mahayanistic school of yogacharas, the highest reality is a pure and undifferentiated spiritual element that represents the non-relative substratum of all phenomena. To be sure, they thereby do not assert, as the old Vedanta does, that as ens realissimum, the highest essence, is identical with the universe, the relation between the two is rather being defined as being neither different nor not different. It is only in the later Buddhist systems of the Far East that the undivided absolute consciousness is taken to be the basis of the manifold world of phenomena. But in contrast to the old Vedanta, it is never maintained that the world is an unfoldment from the unchangeable, eternal, blissful absolute. Suffering and passions manifest in the world of plurality are rather traced back to worldly delusion. On the other hand, the doctrines of later Buddhist philosophy had a far-reaching influence on Vedanta. It is well known that Gautapada and other representatives of later Vedanta taught an illusionistic acosmism for which true reality it is only the eternally pure, eternally awakened, eternally redeemed universal spirit, whilst all manifoldness is only delusion. The Brahman has therefore not developed into the world, as asserted by the old Vedanta, but it forms only the world's unchangeable background comparable to the white screen on which appear the changing images of an unreal shadow play. In my opinion, there was in later times, especially since the Christian era, much mutual influence of Vedanta and Buddhism. But originally, the systems are diametrically opposed to each other. The Atman doctrine of the Vedanta and the Dharma theory of Buddhism exclude each other. The Vedanta tries to establish an Atman as the basis of everything, whilst Buddhism maintains that everything in the empirical world is only a stream of passing dharmas, impersonal evanescent processes, which therefore has to be characterized as anatta, being without a persisting self, without independent existence. Again and again, scholars have tried to prove a closer connection between the early Buddhism of the Pali text and the Vedanta of the Upanishad. They have even tried to interpret Buddhism as a further development of the Atman doctrine. There are, example, two books which shows that tendency, the Vedantic Buddhism of the Buddha by J.G. Jennings, Oxford University Press, 1947, and in German language, The Soul Problem of Early Buddhism by Herbert Gunther Constance, 1949. The essential difference between the conception of deliverance in Vedanta and in Pali Buddhism lies in the following ideas. Vedanta sees deliverance as the manifestation of a state which, through obscured, has been existing from time immemorial. For the Buddhists, however, Nirvana is a reality which differs entirely from all dharmas as manifested in samsara, and which only becomes effective if they are abolished. To sum up, the Vedantin wishes to penetrate to the last reality which dwells within him as an immortal essence or seed out of which everything has arisen. The follower of Pali Buddhism, however, hopes by complete abandoning of all corporeality, all sensation, all perceptions, all volitions, and all acts of consciousness to realize a state of bliss which is entirely different from all that exists in the samsara. After these introductory remarks, we shall now discuss systematically the relation of original Buddhism and Vedanta. 1. First of all, we have to clarify to what extent a knowledge of Upanishadic text may be assumed for the canonical Pali scriptures. The five old prose Upanishads are, on reason of contents and language, generally held to be pre-Buddhistic. The young Upanishads, in any case those beginning from Maitrayana, were certainly written at the time when Buddhism already existed. The number of passages in the Pali canon dealing with Upanishadic doctrines is very small. It is true that early Buddhism shares many doctrines with the Upanishad: karma, rebirth, liberation through the insight. But these tenets were so widely held in philosophical circles of those times that we can no longer regard the Upanishads as the direct source from which the Buddha has drawn. The special metaphysical concern of the Upanishad, the identity of the individual and the universal Atman, has been mentioned and rejected only in a few passages in the early Buddhist texts, for instance in the saying of the Buddha quoted earlier. Nothing shows better the great distance that separates the Vedanta and the teachings of the Buddha than the fact that the two principal concepts of Upanishadic wisdom, Atman and Brahman, do not appear anywhere in the Buddhist texts, which the clear and distinct meaning of primordial ground of the world, core of existence, ends realismism, the true substance, or similarly. As this holds likewise true for early Jain literature, one must assume that early Vedanta was of no great importance in Magadha at the time of the Buddha and the Mahavira, otherwise the opposition against it would have left more distinct traces in the text of these two doctrines. 2. It is of decisive importance for examining the relation between Vedanta and Buddhism clearly to establish the meaning of the words Atta and Anatta in Buddhist literature. The meaning of the word Attan, nominative Atta, Sanskrit Atman, nominative Atma, divides into two groups: A, in daily usage, Attan, self, serves for denoting one's own person and has the function of a reflexive pronoun. This usage is, for instance, illustrated in the 12th chapter of the Dhammapada. B. As philosophical term, Attan denotes the individual soul as assumed by the Jains and other schools, but rejected by the Buddhists. This individual soul was held to be an eternal, unchangeable spiritual monad, perfect and blissful by nature, although its qualities may be temporarily obscured through its connection with matter. Starting from this view held by heretics, the Buddhist further understands by the term self, Atman, any eternal, unchangeable individual entity, in other words, that which Western metaphysics calls a substance, something existing through and in itself, and not through something else, nor existing attached to or inherent in something else. In the philosophical usage of the Buddhist Attan is therefore any entity of which the heretics wrongly assume that it exists independently of everything else and that it has existence on its own strength. The word anattam, nominative anatta, is a noun, Sanskrit anatma, and means not self, in the sense of an entity that is not independent. The word anatman is found in its meaning of what is not the soul or spirit. Also in Brahmanical Sanskrit sources, Bhagavad Gita 6.6, Sankhara to Brahma Sutra 111, Bible Indica page 76, Vedanta Sara 158. Its frequent use in Buddhism is accounted for by the Buddhist characteristics preference for negative nouns. Phrases like Rupang Anatta are therefore to be translated corporeality is not self, or corporeality is not an independent entity, or similarly. As an adjective, the word anattan changes from the consonantal to the declination anatta, see Sanskrit anatmaka, anatmaya, example Sanyutta Nikaya 2257, Sutta Nipata 356, anattan rupang, anatta sankhare, na pajanati, he does not know that corporeality is without self, that the mental formations are without self. The word anatta is therefore to be translated here by not having the nature of a self, not independent, without persisting self, without an eternal substance, etc. The passage anattan rupang anatta rupang tiyata bhutang na pajanati has to be rendered with regard to corporeality. Having not the nature of a self, he does not know. According to truth, corporeality is not self, not an independent entity. The noun attang and the adjective anatta can both be rendered by without a self, without an independent essence, without a persisting core. Since the Buddhists themselves do not make any difference in the use of these two grammatical forms, this becomes particularly evident in the case of the word anatta, which may be either a singular or plural noun. In the well-known phrase sabbe sankhara anicca, sabbe dhamma anatta, Dhammapada 279, all conditioned factors are existence are transitory. All factors existence whatever, nirvana included, are without a self. It is undoubtedly a plural noun, for the Sanskrit version has sarve dharma anatmana. The fact that the anatta doctrine only purports to state that a dharma is void of a self is evident from the passage in the Sanyutta Nikaya, Sanyutta 3585, Sutta Nipata 454, where it is said, Rupa sunya attenava attaniyenava. Forms are void of self and independent essence and of anything pertaining to a self or self-like. Where Guenther has translated anattam or anatta as not the self, one should use a self instead of the self, because in the Pali canon the word atta does not occur in the sense of universal soul. 3. It is not necessary to assume that the existence of indestructible monads is a necessary condition for a belief in life after death. The view that an eternal, immortal, persisting soul substance is the condition sine qua non of rebirth can be refuted by the mere fact that not only in the old Upanishad, but also in Pythagoras and Empedocles, rebirth is taught without the assumption of an imperishable soul substance. 4. Guanta can substantiate his view only through arbitrary translation which contradict the whole of Buddhist tradition. This is particularly evident in those passages where Guanta asserts that the Buddha mean the same by Nirvana and Atman, and that Nirvana is true nature of man, for in Udana 8.2, Nirvana is expressly described as Anattam, which is rightly rendered by the commentator Dhammapala's commentary to the Udana, Udana 21, as Atta Virahita, without a self. And in Vinaya page 86, Nirvana is said to be just as the conditioned factors of existence, Sankata, without a self, page 151. Neither can the question Atman equal Nirvana be proved by the well-known phrase Atta Deepa Viharata Dhamma Deepa. For whether Deepa here means lamp or island of deliverance, this passage can after all only refer to the monks taking refuge in themselves and in the doctrine Dhamma, and Attang and Dhamma cannot possibly be interpreted as Nirvana. In the same way, too, it is quite preposterous to translate Dhammapada 160, Attai Attano Nato, as Nirvana is for a man the leader, page 155. For the chapter is concerned only with the idea that we should strive hard and purify ourselves. Otherwise, Guenther would have to translate in the following verse 161. Attanava katam papam attajang atta sambhavam. By Nirvana, evil is done. It arises without of Nirvana. It has its origin in Nirvana. It is obvious that this kind of interpretation must lead to manifestly absurd consequences. 5. As far as I can see, there is not a single passage in the Pali canon where the word Atta is used in the sense of the Upanishadic Atman, except a few passages rejecting it, as the one quoted by author, the same is the world as the self. See also Sutta Nipata verse 477. And one of the six ego beliefs rejected in Majjhima Nikaya 2, even by the self one perceive the self, this view occurs to him as being true and correct. Attanava attanan sanjanamiti, GF Bhagavad Gita 4.19. Yatra chiu atmana atmanam pasyam Atmani tusyati. This is not surprising, since the word Atman, current in all Indian philosophical systems, has the meaning of universal soul, ens realissimum, the absolute exclusively in the panentheistic and theopantheistic Vedanta. But in the sense it is alien to all other Brahmanical and non-Buddhist doctrines. Why then should it have a Vedantic meaning in Buddhism? As far as I know, no one has ever conceived the idea of giving to the term Atman a Vedantic interpretation. In the case of Nyaya, Vaisheshika, classical Sankhya Yoga, Mimamsa or Jainism. 6. The fact that in the Pali canon all worldly phenomena are said to be anatta has induced some scholars of the West to look for an Atman in Buddhism. For instance, the following great syllogism was formulated by George Grimm: what I perceive to arise and to cease and to cause suffering to me on account of that impermanence cannot be my ego. Now I perceive that everything cognizable in me and around me arises and ceases, and cause me suffering on account of its impermanence. Therefore, nothing cognizable is my ego. From that Grimm concludes that there must be an eternal ego substance that is free from all suffering and above all cognizability. This is a rash conclusion. By teaching that there is nowhere in the world a persisting Atman, the Buddha has not asserted that there must be a transcendental Atman, i.e. a self beyond the world. This kind of logic resembles that of a certain Christian sect which worships its masters as Christ on earth and tries to prove the simultaneous existence of several Christs from Mark 13:22, where it is said, "False Christs and false prophets shall arise, for if there are false Christs, there must also be genuine Christ." The denial of an imperishable Atman is common ground for all systems of Hinayana as well as Mahayana, and there is therefore no reason for the assumption that Buddhist tradition, unanimous on that point, has deviated from the original doctrine of the Buddha. If the Buddha, contrary to the Buddhist tradition, had actually proclaimed a transcendental Atman, a reminiscence of it would have been pursued somehow by one of the numerous sects. It is remarkable that even the Pudgala Vadins, who assumed a kind of individual soul, never appealed to texts in which an Atman in the sense of proclaimed. He who advocates such a revolutionary conception of the Buddha's teaching has also the duty to so evidence how such a complete transformation started and grew suddenly or gradually. But none of those who advocate the Atman theory has taken pains to comply with that demand, which is indispensable to a historian. 7. In addition to the aforementioned reason, there are other grounds too which speak against the supposition that the Buddha has identified Atman and Nirvana. It remains quite incomprehensible why the Buddha should have used this expression, which is quite unsuitable for Nirvana and would have aroused only wrong association in his listeners. Though it is true that Nirvana shares with a Vedantic conception of Atman the qualification of eternal peace into which the liberated ones enter forever, on the other hand, the Atman is, in Brahmanical opinion, something mental and conscious, a description which does not hold true for Nirvana. Furthermore, Nirvana is not like the Atman, the primordial ground or the divine principle of the world, Aitareya Up 1.1. Nor is it that which preserves order in the world, Bhadraranyaka Upanishad 3.8.9. It is also not the substance from which everything evolves, nor the core of all material elements. 8. Since the scholarly researches made by Otto Risomberg, published in Russian 1918, in German Tiers 1924, the Szczebelski 1932, and the great work of translation done by Louis de la Wally Posin on the Abhidharma course 1923-1931, there cannot be any doubt about the basic principle of Buddhist philosophy. In the light of these researchers, all attempts to give to the Atman a place in the Buddhist doctrine appear to quite antiquated. We know now that all Hinayana and Mahayana schools are based on the Anatma Dharma theory. This theory explains the world through the causal cooperation of a multitude of transitory factors, dharma, arising in mutual functional dependence. This theory maintains that the entire process of liberation consists in the tranquilization of these incessantly arising and disappearing factors. For that process of liberation, however, is required, apart from moral resistance, sila, and meditative concentration, samadhi, the insight, prajna, that all conditioned factors of existence, sankhara, are transitory, without a permanent independent existence, and therefore subject to grief and suffering. The nirvana which the saint experiences already in this life and which he enters forever after death is certainly a reality, dharma. But as it is neither arises nor vanishes, it is not subject to suffering and is thereby distinguished from all conditions realities. Nirvana, being a dharma, is likewise anatta, just as transitory conditions, dharmas of the samsara, which as caused by volitions, that is karma producing energies, sankhara, are themselves also called sankhara. Like them, nirvana is no individual entity which could, will, or act independently. For it is the basic idea of the entire system that all dharmas are devoid of Atman, and without cogent reasons we cannot assume that the Buddha himself has taught something different from that which, since more than 2000 years, his followers have considered to be the quintessence of their doctrine.